Hey you guys, welcome back to my channel and welcome to part three of dealing with, confronting your client fears. I still haven't come up with a title for this series yet because I'm filming these all at once, as you can see by the fact that I'm wearing the exact same outfit in every video. Hope you don't mind. But yes, this series is about your kind of worst fears when it comes to working with clients. Some of them have come, some of these fears have been submitted by people who already work with clients like I do. And some of them have come from people who just would like to work with clients but haven't yet. So I have grouped these all into kind of different collections of fears. We already tackled confidence and yeah, kind of like dealing with self-confidence and knowing when you're ready. And then we also last week talked about communication and revisions, of course. Those are like some of my biggest fears. So we talked about that last week. And then this week, we're going to talk about deadlines and boundaries. So yeah, that's what's on tap. I'm just going to go ahead and dive right in. All right. Fear number one is the fear of getting in over my head and not being able to finish on time. So whenever I read, I don't know how many people submitted this one. A lot of people submitted a version of this. And this was one of my biggest fears when I was first getting started. It was one of the things that kind of held me back and made me feel like I didn't want to reach out to clients because I was imagining one step down the road, like, well, you know, what if I actually did get a client project and what would happen then? Like, what if I couldn't finish on time? And then when I start, I never actually did reach out. and then when I started getting client inquiries, that really brought the fear to the surface. And I just, you know, had my sweaty palms trying to sit at my computer and reply and figure out, what do I even tell this person? I don't know how long this is going to take me. I'm afraid I'm going to commit to a date and then not be able to deliver. I don't want to be like that flaky artist that everybody thinks of. So I will tell you what has worked the best for me. And that is knowing how long my process takes. And that is something, like all of these things, that gets easier with time. You do get more familiar with it, but there are things that you can do. There are steps that you can take when you're first getting started, or, you know, maybe you have your kind of consistent portfolio, but you haven't really started working with clients yet. There are some things that you can do to start kind of observing and cataloging and getting a handle on how long your process actually takes so that you can clearly estimate time for a client. And I know that there are going to be some of you out there saying, because I would have said this at one point, oh, it's not possible. There's no way I can, you know, my process is different every time. It's, you know, it's anywhere from 2 hours to 35 hours. And sure. Okay. So there is some variability there, but there are some things that you can do to start getting a sense of what your average time input is. So as you're making work, as you're making personal pieces, just start paying attention to how long you spend at the concept phase. How long, and again, everyone's process is so different here. So if I mention a phase that you don't really have, maybe you have a different phase, just you know what your own process is. And hopefully after last week's video, you have kind of listed out the different things that you do, the different phases of your process. So if you already have that, then you can start building on that and saying like, okay, well, how long does it take for me to look for reference photos? How long does it take for me to do thumbnails? How long does it take for me to do sketches? And just the next 10 pieces that you do, just write it down, start tracking, or maybe the next 5 pieces that you do, have a stopwatch with you, start timing yourself on these different things. Don't necessarily have a goal. You're just observing how long this takes you and start tracking it in like a journal or an Excel document or whatever. Start getting a sense for what your average amount of time is, and maybe even make some notes on these pieces like, okay, well, this piece took, 5 hours and it was an 8x10. This piece took 7 hours and it was 11x14, and taking note of the content, the different subjects. Like for me, I know that any person, any portrait, any painting of people is always going to take longer than a painting of food. And that's something that I have learned through experience and observation. If you're not actively paying attention to it, you may just feel like, oh, this process is mystical, it's magical, it's happening out of my control, I can't possibly understand or predict. And there will be that element to it, but there are also a lot of things you can do to understand and predict. So try to start that process just by paying attention when you're making it, when you're making your pieces, paying attention to how long each of these phases takes you. After a little while, when you do have some kind of a broad sense of how long a piece of a certain size or a certain subject matter might take you, and maybe you get a client inquiry or two, or you send out some emails to clients and they're interested in knowing more about your process, I would recommend that you build out a 20 to 30% buffer on the time that it actually takes you to create a piece. Now, I don't have that same kind of buffer anymore, but it is something that I did constantly when I was the first few years that I was working. And it's one of those few things I look back and I say, that was really good that I did that, because it enabled me to finish on time all the time. There probably are some things that are unhealthy about this, if I'm honest, but I have never asked for an extension on a project. That's not to say that you can't. It's perfectly fine and professional to ask for extensions. There are definitely times that I should have asked for an extension. We can have another video therapy with Kendall sometime where I unpack why I have a problem asking for extensions, but that's not what we're talking about today. But I do think my version, the thing I did instead of that, was having this 20 to 30% wiggle room built in. So if I knew that something was going to take me 3 days, I would ask for 4 days. I don't have to tell the client that. You don't have to tell the client that. All I would put on the proposal was, you know, the specific dates, like the date that the sketch would be done, the date that they'd need to have feedback done, the date. And I can say 4 days, that's like 4 days of working time. It might actually be longer in actual project time, because, you know, maybe you need a day to do the sketches and you deliver the sketches, and then they need a day to do feedback, and then you need 2.5 days to do the color or whatever. So just building in that buffer, building in that wiggle room, especially if you're new, especially if you are not super confident in estimating your time, always ask for more time with the client than you think that you'll need. Always ask for as much time as you can get, because every client loves to have the work delivered early. And it's much better in my experience to under promise and over deliver. So tell them it's going to take you 6 days and then finish in only 4 days, and they're going to be happy, as opposed to if you told them it was going to take you 4 days and then you didn't finish for six, you know, that's going to be a little bit trickier. So, and again, I'm saying all this stuff, probably making it sound like it's not okay to ask for an extension. I don't want you guys to have the problem that I have of not asking for them. It's fine to ask for an extension. If you are going to ask for an extension, what you should do is ask for it as soon as you need it. So it's kind of another version of what we just said, of asking for more time than you think you're going to maybe use, or then asking for more time just in case you need it. So if you're partway into a project and you're starting to think, ooh, this is like maybe a little bit dicey, I don't know if I'm going to be able to finish on time, just reach out right away. Don't do it the day before. Don't do it the day of the deadline. Reach out right away and say, hey, just want to let you know, this is taking a little bit longer than I anticipated, or I had, you know, my cat is sick, or whatever it is, whatever the reason for things taking a little bit longer, just reach out right away, let them know and say, will it be possible to get, you know, 2 extra days or whatever it is? And then, you know, maybe in the end you won't need it. So I think the tendency is to like wait until last minute and then to ask last minute, and that's going to be a little bit trickier. Better just to get it, rip off the Band-Aid, get it out of the way, ask right away. And then, you know, if you don't need it, then so much the better. All of that, estimating how much time it takes for you to work on a project, sharing that information with the client, and I guess I wouldn't know this from experience, but I assume asking for extensions gets easier the more that you do it, like everything we are talking about in the series. I hope I'm not just going to sound like a big broken record, but yeah, that's what's happening. So moving on to the next fear, and that is, I guess this one is more of a challenge. That was kind of how it was worded, but the challenge of dealing with really invasive clients, clients who push boundaries, clients who, you know, want additional calls or maybe after hours calls. That was another theme that came up quite a bit. And like many of the fears and challenges that we have tackled so far, the best thing to do here is to have some structure. So to have a set policy going in for how you approach these things. So since most of the clients that I work with, this is a disclosure here, I guess, most of the clients I work with are companies and corporations who, you know, liaise with me through an art director. I'm not working with a ton of like solopreneurs or small businesses, not working with them directly. So in my experience, there tends to be a little bit more kind of natural separation, since everybody that I'm working with is on the the professional clock, I guess. So most people are on some sort of 9 to 5. Sometimes I have to do after hours things because of people being in a different time zone or whatever. But for the most part, we're all kind of on office hours, office time. But if you're working with a small business or you're working with somebody who's kind of a startup and who's maybe doing things on the weekends or in the evenings, there may be more of a push from that kind of a client to have access to you in non-business hours. That's not to say that they should, and that's totally up to you. This is a very kind of personal thing. People are going to have different comfort levels with this, different comfort levels, even with something like being willing to be on a Zoom or on a phone call. Some people want to do it all by email. I'm not here to tell you what you have to do or what the standard is. But what I am here to tell you is that you should communicate whatever it is, whatever your boundaries are, however you want things to go, however you want to be communicated with, it's on you to communicate that to the client. So a good thing to do is to just have a paragraph or a section in your agreement, whether it's going to be an email agreement or a contract, where you really kind of clearly lay out what the best practices as far as communication goes, what those best practices for you are. So tell them, really be explicit, tell them the best way to contact you. If the best way to contact you is by email, then say that. Also can be really helpful to let them know when they can expect to hear back from you. And if you're willing to do an initial Zoom call to onboard, which is what I do, I'm pretty standardly will do some sort of onboarding call, whether it's a video or a phone. And then, you know, maybe you want to have a set number of additional calls. Maybe there could be one call at each round of revision. But you also don't have to do that. You could try to do this all by email if you want to. That being said, there are some times when the phone is really helpful, but yes, have that all laid out. And just like with the revisions, be really specific that if they go beyond that, then it's going to increase the scope. So, you know, each project has, you know, say you're like me and you have three rounds of revision, and, you know, maybe you have an initial Zoom call and then two phone calls. And if they want additional phone calls beyond that, then it's going to be billed at your usual hourly rate, which is, you know, whatever your hourly rate is. I think especially if you have seen that requests for additional Zoom calls or requests for additional phone calls or after hours business calls are a challenge for you, if that's something that's come up several times, then it's even more important to build this kind of structure in. As I've already said, I have done this in some projects. I have clearly laid it out in some projects, but it's not been a big challenge for me. And that is one boundary that wouldn't be that hard for me to assert. If I have somebody who's calling after business hours, it's just not that hard for me to not pick up the phone. I just don't do it. But if it is hard for you, that's okay. And building in some of these structures will hopefully help take some of the pressure off. And if you have told the client upfront, this is the boundary, my guess is it's going to make it a little bit easier for you to hold it, because that's what happens to me with the boundaries that are difficult to hold. If I have said them up front, it's easier to do, because then I feel like at least, you know, I told the client about this. It's not like they feel like I'm switching things on them last minute. And of course, there is no way to completely remove the discomfort here. At a certain level, even if you're super explicit and you lay out all of these constraints for how the communication and the process will go, at some point somebody will step outside of that, whether it's because they're intentionally trying to push the boundary or because they didn't read the contract thoroughly enough. There will be some point when you have to actually say no. So if that's what is at the root of the problem, then you're going to have to address that at some point, and you're going to have to accept the fact that saying no and choosing that you want to maintain your boundary is more important to you than the discomfort that you feel from actually having to do that. All right, so moving on to the final fear for this video. All right, so the third and final fear for this video is the fear of receiving an overwhelming or a bad contract or somehow getting in over your head legally. All right, this was another really big fear for me when I first started out. I remember trying to do all kinds of reading, but I didn't even really know what I was looking for or what I should try to understand. So I would recommend a few resources to you. just as a good starting point so that you can have some literacy on the subject. Number one is a video that I have already done on freelance illustration contracts. I'm not going to go over everything that's in that video in this one because I have already made that video. Also, my new Skillshare class has a lot of that same, has all of that same information and actually more, and a little bit more in depth. Both of those things will be linked in the description box. And the GAG guide, the Graphic Artist Skilled Handbook for Pricing and Ethical Guidelines that I mention all the time on this channel. You're probably sick of hearing about it, but that's another really great resource for contracts. There's contract templates in there and a really helpful kind of glossary of terms. And they also have sections, you know, in each of the specific types of illustration sections, there's like a paragraph or two on kind of common legal practices or rights or the ways that things usually go in those niches. And then also the other resource is just Googling specific terms. So a lot of the time people will ask me questions about this kind of stuff and I'm like, hey, I don't actually know that one, but I can tell you what I would do. I would just Google it. And getting comfortable with trying to figure things out on your own, and asking for help is definitely great. And you can do what people do and sometimes email me, but I'm not a legal expert. There are plenty of people who are artists that know more about legal stuff than I do. And then there are, of course, lawyers themselves who would be the best people to ask about this. Knowing and accepting you do not have to be a legal expert here. You're never going to fully understand intellectual property law, and that's okay because you're an illustrator, not a lawyer. But we are just aiming for some kind of basic literacy here and enough to, you know, A, hopefully spot red flags, and B, realize when you are in over your head and ask for help, because you probably will get in over your head at some point, and that is totally okay. You just need to know how to ask for help and know what the signals are. All right, so we're going to go over a few things to keep in mind regarding illustration contracts. And if you want to know, again, if you want to know the things that I recommend to put into an illustration contract, watch that video or take that Skillshare class, because we're not going to go over those specific things right now. All right, first thing I want to mention is that the stakes are higher with larger projects, bigger contracts, projects that are going to go on for a longer period of time. So if you're dealing with that kind of a contract, if this is a bigger project that's going to extend for months and months, or something that potentially has a high price tag, you should seek legal counsel. So a lot of the contracts that I get are for things that are, you know, shorter term, things that I'm very familiar with, like packaging. So I don't ask for legal help on that. And for editorial, which, you know, in the grand scheme of things is relatively small for the most part. And again, I feel very comfortable with those contracts. I don't usually ask somebody to look those over for me. I have gotten pretty familiar with all those things just from reading and Googling terms and learning kind of what to look for and what to watch out for. That being said, if I were to get a contract for a children's book or for, you know, like a really big corporation or maybe like a TV show or I'm trying to think of something that I haven't done before. I don't know, like an album cover. No, I have it in it. Yes, I have done an album cover. But I still don't know it super well. Anyway, if it was a big project, if it was a small project in an unfamiliar area, I'd probably still just read it myself and figure it out myself. But if it's a big project, and we all would define that somewhat differently, but for me, a large part of what makes something seem like what makes something a big project is how long it's going to go on. So if I agree to some terms that I later realize are not very good, and I'm just working on like one or two illustrations for a couple of weeks, I will be frustrated and it will motivate me to learn more and to not do that again. But if I were to agree to terms that were for a contract that was going to last like, you know, 6 months or 12 months or 18 months, which some longer, larger things can, I would just want to bang my head against the wall. I would be so exasperated. So that I know for me is that's like a big deciding factor. So if it was going to go on longer, I would be a lot more likely to ask a lawyer to look it over for me. I do have somebody that I would go to. And somebody who's answered some questions for me in the past, I would just send it to him and see what he said there. So, all right, the next point is, a client may send you a contract. A client will hopefully send you a contract, but just because they have sent you a contract, it does not mean that you have to sign it. And, that sounds very basic and maybe you're rolling your eyes, but I would guess for most of you, when you are actually in the moment, when you have received the contract, especially if you're kind of new at this, you probably feel pressured to just go ahead and sign it as it is. Or when you imagine asking for changes, you probably feel a bit like, oh, I don't want to do that. I don't want to rock the boat. What if me asking for a change makes them say, oh, forget it. We're going to find somebody else. I'm here to say that you can and should ask for changes. It's a very normal thing to do. It happens all the time. Many small companies use form contracts. I'd say probably most small companies use form contracts that are not specifically written, maybe even not specifically written for them. And then larger companies that do have contracts that are specifically written for them are often not specifically written for illustrators. And they're certainly not written specifically for you. So you are just asking to have what is a form updated to actually be appropriate for you and the work that you're providing. And something that they may say, something that clients sometimes say is, well, you know, other illustrators, they were fine with this, or every other illustrator we work with is okay with this. And you can say, well, yes, that's a self-selecting pool. If the prerequisite is that you have to sign it as it is, then yes, every other illustrator you work with is okay with this, because those are the only illustrators who will be willing to work with you. But please know that not every illustrator is okay with that. And I have turned down and walked away from plenty of projects because I was not happy with the contract. And there was one I still think about actually a couple of years ago for a cool kind of higher end grocery store chain in the Boston area. And they wanted to have a total all rights buyout for the price of a spot illustration. And I, at the time, I was really tempted because it was just such a cool project. And I really wanted to do it, but I was like, I can't for the rights that they're asking for. I could have done it for that price. I would have found a way to do it for that price, but only with much more limited rights. So, and I guess I should go ahead and mention here, we should at least raise and be honest about the fact that part of what comes into this consideration is, you know, if you are me being able to turn down a project and walk away from it, puts me in a more powerful position in terms of negotiating a contract. And I'm able to do that. I have been able to do that because of having some privilege, and the privilege of having a steady, relatively steady client stream for a couple of years. So that puts me in a stronger negotiating position. I'm not saying that in any sort of a braggy way. I just mean, I don't want you to feel bad if you are new at this and you're trying to negotiate and you ask the client for changes and they come back and they say, well, every other illustrator we work with is okay with this. You honestly don't have a ton of things that you can say back to that if you're not willing to walk away. So if you have to take the job, if you really need the money, you have to take the job, you could maybe say something like, well, can I have a day to show this to my lawyer or whatever? Maybe you're not even going to show it to your lawyer, but they'll hopefully give you the day to show it to your lawyer. Maybe that will make them feel a little bit more flexible. Or if you need to, you can take the work if you need to. It's okay to take the work if you need to. Trying to negotiate with your contract and trying to retain more of your rights, those are things that you will hopefully be able to do more of as you're more established. It is really hard at the beginning. It is hard to do that. The thing that I'm encouraging you to do is still to ask. So a lot of the time we feel, oh, it's hard to do that. So then we don't even ask. We don't even bring up making the change. But there are plenty of situations where the client will be okay with making the change and they won't mind. They'll, you know, you can say, hey, I made some edits onto the PDF. Would you mind incorporating these? And there are plenty of clients that are going to be okay with that. So yes, there will be some clients that aren't. And then you have to decide, then you're in the difficult position of deciding whether you want to, you know, say that you're willing to walk away from it and see what they say. I have done that and had it turn out where they said, okay, well, you know, we'll change the contract. And that's happened a number of times. And I've done that and they've said, okay, we'll find somebody else. And both of those things were okay because of the position that I was in when I made that statement when I decided to take that stand. But it's going to be different for every person, going to be different for every circumstance. So I guess on that note, that kind of leads us into what we're going to talk about next week. We're pretty much done for this week's video, but next week we're going to talk about money. So we already were kind of starting to dance around it some here at the end of this video, but next week, the final installment in the Client Fears series is going to be money stuff. All right, you guys, I hope everybody is having a great week. Thank you for watching. Thank you for the comments you've been leaving. I really appreciate it. I'm so, I appreciate everybody who leaves comments and everybody who watches and, all of that. All right, you guys, happy Friday. I will see you in the next video. Bye.